I understand that when you were 11 years old, there was a schoolboy who set your pigtails on fire. And you were taking a test. You turned around and with your hands snuffed out the fire and then proceeded to finish your test. Is that a true story?
It is a true story. I was a bit surprised to see that pop up today. It's one of the stories I occasionally tell because it had some very unfortunate consequences. Afterwards, my mother gave me a bowl haircut. So for the school photograph later in that week, I look like Richard III, or as if I'm going to be in a permanent...
Well, I think it underscores the fact that you speak truth, that you are steely, and I truly respect that.
Remarkable testimony from Dr. Fiona Hill. It closed out an intense week of public impeachment hearings. Dr. Hill, a Russia expert who served three presidents, who right out of the gate called out the president and his party for pushing conspiracy theories and explained the dual tracks of Ukrainian policy coming out of the White House, garnered the attention of the nation, a nation that Dr. Hill herself spoke highly of, recognizing that it was America that provided her with opportunities she would not have had anywhere else.
I grew up poor with a very distinctive working class accent. In England in the 1980s and 1990s, this would have impeded my professional advancement. This background has never set me back in America.
We are very lucky to be joined by her attorney, Lee Wielosky. You were by her side, but you've known her for 30 years. Tell us how you know her.
Yeah, I have. We met at Harvard in the early 1990s. As she said, she left England, where she came from a working class background. Her father's family worked in the coal mines. Her mother's family actually worked in the sewers of northern England. And with that type of background, as talented as you are, at that time, she probably correctly concluded that she needed to leave England and come to the United States in order to fulfill her potential. And of course, she has since become our country's and perhaps the world's expert on Putin, the Russian security services. She literally wrote the book on Vladimir Putin, and she's now served under three U.S. presidents to contribute her nonpartisan expertise in furtherance of our national security and our interests and values.
So I got to just be blunt. How could she work for Donald Trump?
Well, as she said in her opening statement, she felt that she wanted to do what President Trump stated that he intended to do, which is improve the bilateral relationship with Russia while dealing with the serious threats that Russia posed to the security of the United States. But she said in her testimony and believes that it is very important for us to figure out a way to have a stabilized relationship with Russia. And so she believed the president's words that he wanted to improve the relationship. And frankly, Donald Trump probably does want to improve the relationship. We can talk about, or she can talk about, because I'm really here today as her lawyer.
I know. But I mean, you represent her. You navigated her through this impeachment proceeding. I mean, do you have any visibility into how she experienced flashpoints like Helsinki, where Donald Trump, I mean, she was part of our country's intelligence agencies. He stood there in Helsinki next to Putin and said, I believe Putin, not the intelligence agencies.
Yeah, but I think she would say that there are other things that happened even at Helsinki, and that, again, further to her goal of improving the relationship, there were channels that were further during that process, and particularly on the arms control side, which is important for all of us. So she decided to serve. And, you know, I think one of the points that she wanted me to express on your air is that over the course of the past 2 weeks, the American people have got to meet a number of the nonpartisan experts who have served our government in furtherance of their own security, the American people's security, and the interests and values of our country. And so we have to be careful when we talk about conspiracy theories about those people, and when we refer to the swamp in Washington, there is a swamp in Washington, but these fine experts are out to further our security against our adversaries. They're out to further America's position in the world and to advance our interests and values. And the American people have now had a chance to meet them.
The American people have had a chance to meet them. The American people, I think it's fair to say, by and large, respect them. And in her case, a lot of them revere her. But Donald Trump essentially poured cow poop on her when he went on Fox and Friends this morning and repeated a conspiracy theory that literally 24 hours earlier, she rebuked his allies in Congress for doing.
Yes. She, as she said, she wants to have nothing to do with these conspiracy theories about Ukraine having interfered in our elections. It was a Russian disinformation campaign. Again, that's being reported.
Was or is? I mean, is, that is still.
Is. As of today, there are reports, fresh reports, that the intelligence community has renewed its warnings to the Senate on precisely this issue. So these are very real concerns that she has that have been validated.
Is she concerned that, I mean, Michael Steele knows this version of the Republican Party as well as anyone, as does Tim Miller. Is she concerned that 40% of the country doesn't believe these fine professionals? Because they don't believe that they don't need to see the evidence. They're not open to a trial. They've already decided how it's going to end.
Yeah, I mean, she went through yesterday what evidence that exists for the proposition of Ukrainian interference in our elections. It's really an article from Politico, and that's pretty much about it. So, as she pointed out in her testimony, the article from Politico actually doesn't say what members of the conspiracy theory about Ukraine and CrowdStrike say it says. It concludes that, in fact, there was no evidence of any top-down Ukrainian government interference in our elections, as opposed to what the Russians did to us.
She was very careful to describe herself as a fact witness, but she also was very clear, both in her opening statement, which I assume you guys collaborated on, and in questioning, to say that she felt as a fact witness she had a moral obligation to be there. Does she think John Bolton does too?
I don't know.
Do you?
I'm just her mouthpiece today.
I do. I think you should be there.
Let me just pursue this as just, you've worked in government. I mean, when you're, and I think Tom Friedman wrote this about Mike Pompeo, when your soldiers are on the battlefield, is it honorable to leave them out there taking arrows from people like Devin Nunes?
Yeah, I mean, I worked in government, you work in government. I think that one of the most important points, actually, that she made yesterday was that what was happening with Gordon Sondland and Rudy Giuliani and the president, according to Sondland's testimony, is that they basically co-opted U.S. foreign policy making, national security decision making for political purposes. She said that Sondland was on a domestic political errand. And you've been in government, you know that when you're in high office, your goal is to advance the interests of the United States. It's not to advance the interest of any particular U.S. politician. And that was what was so pernicious about what happened here, as she stated yesterday.
But I think one of the most dramatic moments, I think we might have it, was when she said, and oh, God, I love that she explained what happens to women who get mad in the workplace. I'm gonna save that on my phone and play it every time. Let's watch it, because I love this.
I had a bit of a blow-up with Ambassador Sondland, and I had a couple of testy encounters with him. I was actually, to be honest, angry with him. And, I hate to say it, but often when women show anger, it's not fully appreciated. It's often, you know, pushed onto emotional issues, perhaps, or deflected onto other people.
And what she was angry about was she thought he'd gone rogue. She realizes, in part, I think, from his testimony the day before, right, that he was on an errand from the president.
A domestic political errand, which was not foreign policy. So we have a hefty agenda with the Ukrainians, bilateral agenda, that is meant from our perspective to advance our security and our interests and values, a fragile democracy that is building itself toward the West, trying to emulate our interests and values, trying to build the rule of law. And that's been taken hostage by a re-election of a U.S. politician. That is contrary, I think she would say, to how our country is supposed to work, how our foreign policy and national security decision-making is supposed to work, where you're supposed to be advancing the interests of our country.
And she came to understand that it was the president that Gordon Sondland was answering to, right? That was her testimony yesterday?
And that was his testimony the day before, that the president told him to do these things.
She was the first witness who seemed to have internalized and almost intellectualized all of the previous testimony. Can I just go through with you what you think was established over these 2 weeks as someone who obviously went about that endeavor with her? Do you feel that it was clearly established that military aid and a meeting with President Zelensky were conditioned on a public commitment to conduct investigations into Burisma in 2016?
Well, that seems to be what the evidence is, and most of that was established during time periods after she left the NSC on July 19th.
Do you believe that the attacks on the whistleblower have any legal significance, or do you think the fact that everything in the whistleblower complaint was corroborated by 17 witnesses, I think 11 of them political appointees?
Yeah, I mean, look, again, this is Lee Wielosky, not Fiona Hill. You know, at some point, you sort of have to look at the totality of the evidence. And
the public testimony.
And how it sort of came about is interesting, but it's not determinative of what the body of the evidence is.
Representing someone who I think came to symbolize what you said she hoped people would see, these nonpartisan, non-political public servants who are truly the best of the best in their subject area. Do you think that representing someone who is sort of the highest level of that, what do you think they want to see happen?
It's a good question. I mean, I think that all of us who care about our country most of all, as opposed to who's going to win a particular election, and remember, these people are nonpartisan. They serve in all administrations.
Right.
I think that, you know, again, I think the most serious concern is when domestic politics start to infect that process, which has been set up to be non-political because it is intended to advance the interests of our country, 300 million plus Americans mm-hmm. who depend on that part of our government to keep them safe and to advance our interests as a country in the world. So when that process gets impeded or infected, and the national security process gets infected and impeded by domestic politics, that is, I think, what many of us who've worked in this area would want to prevent.
Do you think, this is my last question, you've been so generous with your time, she didn't testify to this, and I wonder if she had an answer if she'd been asked. Was anyone other than Donald Trump opposed to releasing the military aid for Ukraine?
Well, you know, a lot of the key events with respect to military aid happened after she left. But I think as she and other witnesses testified, it was the bipartisan consensus of the Ukraine policy community that the aid should be released. She had at one point opposed lethal military assistance for Ukraine, but that was in an earlier period when the Ukrainian Defense Forces, she felt, were not properly equipped to handle it. She was also concerned about Russian escalation dominance during that time period earlier. But, you know, I think it was pretty much of a unanimous viewpoint that lethal military assistance was important to deter the Russians.
And that a matter of life and death, as Bill Taylor said.
Life and death, absolutely, for them, and also critical to our country in terms of our willingness to confront Russian aggression across Europe.
Hey there, I'm Chris Hayes from MSNBC. Thanks for watching MSNBC on YouTube. If you want to keep up to date with the videos we're putting out, you can click subscribe just below me or click over on this list to see lots of other great videos.